there's a bit of sad news. Sorry, last Friday, one of our former players, Ben Lott, passed away after a battle with cancer. So on behalf of the Thirroul Rugby League football community, just like to pass on our condolences to his wife and two kids, all his family and his friends. 40 is a bit too young to be losing your battle with cancer. So hopefully they can move forward and rest in peace, Benny. Now, on to the show. We've now got a name called the send-off, thanks to Lenny Barton. If you have a look at the little intro, and the Ryan's Hotel have jumped on board, given us a few shirts and stuff like that, and a hoodie.
First sponsors,
yes.
Looking to take on a few more if anyone's out there interested.
Yeah, new cars, whatever you want to throw at us. I just had a look, Johnny, and there's about 270 views of the first episode, which is pretty good since I did one once before, and there's about 12, and three of those were me.
Do you reckon out of that 270, they watched it the whole all the way through? Or
I would hope so. There's some good stuff in it. Just for you, mate, thanks a lot for jumping on board. Like, there's been a bit of feedback, and a lot of it's about your sort of expertise on the local.
Don't know about that.
Local comp players and stuff like that. So thanks for getting on board with us. Righto, let's go. Corrimal versus Thirroul last Saturday, and it was a bit of a flogging, 50-8, and it started from the first set of six.
Yeah, it was a big day out at Corrimal. Both sides got down there, and the local community of Corrimal also. Thirroul is a massive crowd out there. A lot of blue and white jumpers, and also a lot of old school Cougars jumpers there, because Corrimal there, they were 2-2 to start the season. It was very promising signs from the Cougars their first 2 weeks, but the Butchers from the opening set just looked on song. Their first set, when Corrimal kicked off to them, they made 70 metres, a nice kick there on the tail end of the set, and you could just feel that the Butchers were in for a huge game, and that's what they did. The score just lapping 50-8, and the two tries to Corrimal came late in the second half there, but a few injuries to the Cougars, and for Sean Malone and all his men down there at Corrimal, I think it's going to be a big turning point in their season. They lost a couple of key players there, their big centre, George Tyson, who's been a standout.
Yeah, I really liked him.
Yeah, Thomas Garrido, he looks like he broke his leg on the tail end of that game, and we actually stopped play 10 minutes shy of the full-time siren due to him just absolutely on his back there at Zeems Park.
Yeah, it's not good.
Let's just hope for him that he can come back. You know, not too bad from that injury, a broken leg. We've seen Thomas Maloney for them last year break his leg and come back, have that miss out on the whole season.
That was sort of their season.
Once he lost it. And you know, they structured their whole season around Thomas Maloney last year, and this year they seem to have structured a lot of their football around guys like George Tyson, the centre that's hurt his knee, the Pommy import.
Have you got any word on that?
It looks like a season for the pair of them. So that could derail
Corrimal.
They lost Ed Hansel the week before as well.
Yeah.
To a knee injury as well. So two of your starting centres, your fullback, out for the season. It's not good for them. But the Butchers, they were super impressive. They were really, really good. Jared Costello would have to be very happy about what he's seen there on Saturday down at Zeems Park. Just from the opening whistle, they were just on song. Great ball movement. And up through the middle was just enormous from Damian, Sironen and Jay Gallagher. Ciro was huge. He was just a meter eater up the middle. They couldn't stop him. And Jay Gallagher out there on those fringes was unreal. The skipper, Joel Johnson, as always, leading from the front out of acting half. Look, there was one marker, a lazy marker, or two markers. He just somehow pinched 10-15 metres with every carry and really got on that front foot. And it allowed Fletcher and also Walshy to really play off the back of that.
Like you said last week, you know, it would be one in the forwards, and Thirroul just dominated through the forwards. I think the first set went from memory, Dodge into Sironen, the European statue. And then
good looking physique on him.
We might have to get a photo of him without his shirt for our female viewers.
Mitch Jennings was chubbed up there in the commentator's box on Saturday.
And then it went on to Jay Gallagher and then up the field.
Yeah, they were just, that first set was perfect. If you've seen a 10 out of 10 set from any rugby league team, that was it. You could rewind that and watch it over and over again. It was perfect.
It just sort of piled on the points from there, and it's just, I don't know, like, there wasn't a lot of mistakes in Thirroul either.
It was a very polished effort there from the Butchers. Look, if any of the opposition teams are going to watch that game, they're just going to stand back and they'll shit themselves. They really will, because the Butchers, they were on song.
Yeah, and there was also a few debuts too, which was good to see. Jacko sort of threw some of them young blokes in there once the score was sort of blown out and gave them a bit of a taste of it. Wayne Duggan,
yeah. So Jacko spoke to me earlier in the year about this bloke. He had huge raps on him. Once Lukey Gallagher wasn't playing, they moved Dodgy back into the back row, and then Duggan was named on the bench, but he started in that left-hand side centre position. Very solid, a great game from him. And then Big Jake Walker, an absolute coke machine with legs, coming off the bench. Both them boys scored tries on debut, so well done to both of them.
Yeah, and then we had some others. Cooper Purcell got a bit of a run as well.
Yeah, look, Cooper Purcell, he's a class act. We've seen him come through the Dragon system. He's a Thirroul junior. It's just a shame he's probably got the best number nine in the competition in front of him, because Coops could get a spot in any first grade side with the number nine on his back.
Yeah, who else jumped on there? Matty Sironen got a bit of a run too, and I thought a few years ago, Matty Sironen was really, really good player.
He played well.
He's not now.
You just put the mock on him there.
Yeah.
No, look, he got limited time there on the weekend. He played reserve grade prior to that game, had a good game, and Jacko put him number 17, or he wore the 18 on his back, but he made Jacko 17 on Saturday, and look, it just shows the depth of this Thirroul Butchers, top two grades, even into the under-18s. Jacko's got a lot of talent there at his disposal this season, as does Couchy and Beathy in that reserve grade, as well as Munger in the under-18s, so... Look, it's good to see that these young guys are getting used in first grade. It's also good to see that Thirroul have got that much depth that if they've got a couple of key players out there, they can rely on guys from the lower grades to step up and put in a good showing every Saturday.
Yeah, that was one other thing. Besides a lot of the injuries for Corrimal, which is sort of a bit disappointing for them, but the depth of Thirroul's club at the moment, you know, I've got the reserve grade team here. You've got people like Luke Shields that have played, Riley Lord that's played some first grade, Mitch Lackerstein's had a bit of a crack at it, Matt Sironen. You've got Jacob Devine.
Jai Richards. Yep. I think Jai got injured on the weekend as well, so I hope it's nothing too serious for Jai.
I look down there and see an old fella's named Ben Couchman pulled on the boots too, I see.
How old is Couchy?
He's about 49, maybe.
Still looking 29?
I think he's around 40, old Couch, but he's... still playing all right, I heard.
I think it's unreal. He gets out there and has a run. And, you know, the younger guys, they're probably half his age that he's playing with. So good on Couchy for going around this season.
He's still probably just as good as him too.
Or just as fit.
Fit, very fit. Yeah, so the club's in really sort of... Jack Eager's another bloke there that's played a bit of first grade.
Yep. He wouldn't look out of place with the number 7 on his back in first grade.
Yeah,
we've seen it over the last couple of years.
So Thirroul's sort of in pretty good shape, and... hopefully that there's not a lot of injuries this year and can really have a good crack at it. Corrimal, what did you make of them?
Yeah, they're going to be tested now. They're really going to be tested. And I had hopes of Corrimal. I really thought they could jump into that top four position come the pointy end of the season. I see Dapdo falling out of the top four this year and Corrimal replacing them. But with the injuries to that key personnel, it's really going to be hard for them to be competitive now towards the tail end of this season. I really feel for Corrimal as well as Sean Maloney. Look, the start of the season, unreal. They looked like they were going to be a promising side this year, but injuries can just cruel any team in this comp, and looks like Corrimal are going to be the benefactors of a few injuries, and it's going to really hamper their performance, and it's not good for the competition in my mind. I just feel that the more depth the competition has, the more even this whole competition is, the better the competition is. It's a bit of a shame when you've got two or three standout sides. You'd rather see four or five competitive sides.
Yeah, I agree. I thought Corrimal would have played a bit better, but in saying that, I don't think Thirroul really allowed them.
They were just blown off the park.
From that first kickoff, they were just on top and dominated with their forwards.
Blew them off the park. That's all they done, just straight up the middle, and then they worked off the back of that. Yeah. When you got the best forward pack, in my mind, in the competition, up against the Corrimal side, it was always going to be a battle for the Cougars.
And you throw in Joel Johnson again, like you said, on your telecast, you know, he just knows where to run, and it's always the right time.
He's the reigning Paul McGregor medalist for a reason. And look, if he's taken from the last couple of weeks we've seen, he's taken the form from last season to this season. There's no way he can't not go back to back for that medal.
Yeah, I think Jake Gallagher might give him a bit of a run for that.
Yeah, also Damian Sironen.
Yeah.
That, look, don't take out Jake Walsh. You know, he's playing off the back of those sensational forwards, and his kicking game the other day was superb, and also his goal kicking. Lukey Gallagher not available for the game on the weekend, and like Gall in his own right, such a good sharp shooter. But I tell you what, Walshy, he kicked them really, really good, and it's going to take a bit for Gall to get them kicking duties back off Walshy, I tend to feel.
I think he only missed one.
Yeah. I think I mocked him as well. I said he's had such a good day with the boots. Probably ate your schooner there, Walshy.
Yeah, so Thirroul, I mean, it's only three rounds in, but they are looking, they're looking good.
It's not just it's the depth. That's what everyone's just really got to be pleased with, is the depth within the three grades. Yeah. I think that's the bit that puts Thirroul above the rest of the competition.
Speaking of depth, this is a bit out there, off. But I went down and watched a bit of the junior footy not long ago. There's some, like, these kids are young, but there is some really good kids in the Thirroul system at the moment. Yeah. And they're getting taught from the coaches, and this is shout out to them, the right way to sort of play footy. They're not being coached to run around, these kids. They got like a game plan to go through them and that. And like, I know Munga and Benny Couchman, and there's probably a few others that are involved in the...
We go down on Fridays to footy training, and Munga's coaching the under-8s, then he does the under-10s, then he runs the under-18s.
Yeah, and Couchy's similar.
So Couchy's similar. Couchy's got the 10s and also got 16. The 16s. So
yeah, with Trent Waterhouse.
Yep.
And he's...
Aaron Cooper, can't forget him.
Yeah.
He helps out down there at the 16s, number one linesman in the district.
Kenny Evan Jr.
Yeah, the new Kenny.
So, and Couchy's the coordinator of the coaching staff in the juniors too.
Yeah.
So club's looking really healthy. We might try and get Paul Eyre on next week and see if he give us a State of the Union sort of an address.
Bit of an update on the juniors.
Or, well, yeah, if he knows it. And if not,
bit of an
seniors,
update of the whole club.
Yeah, see what's going on. Anyway, let's have a look at this week's round. It's against Dapto, and it's on Saturday. Dapto Showground, so another away game for the Butchers. What do you make of them? They've lost every game this year, the Canaries.
Yeah, I think Dapto are they're in a rebuilding phase. They had an ageing roster the last few years. The guys like Mick Henderson, Matty Hancock, JD, Jamie Dunning up front, they were always going to lose a couple of their key players on the wrong side of 30. We can't all be like Aaron Booth and play to 100. So some of these guys have to retire, and that's what Dapto are really going to find. They're going to struggle this year. They've opted for a bit of youth. They're using a couple of young guys that have come through the system, so hopefully they can stick around with Dapto for a few years. But look, the Butchers, they're going to be long odds-on favourites down at Dapto Showground this Saturday. Just the experience the Butchers have got up front, that big mobile pack, playing off the back of that Walshy and also Fletcher. I think they're going to be too good again. Dapto's in for a very, very long season.
Yeah, Dapto have still got some pretty decent players. You know, Jeff Robson's still in the team. You've got Joel Reddy, so there's some experience. But
yeah, got Josh Varchez back, Reece Bowditch up front. So there is a couple of names that have been in the system for a while. But, you know, losing those key players this season than what we've seen Dapto the last few years, it's put a big hole in the Canaries' outfit.
Yeah, and I mean, when Jacko took over the club too, you know, he sort of had to rebuild his first year, and they just missed out on the semis then, but then they've come on strong for him and the recruitment and that, and I gather...
I think that's where Dapto will be.
Dapto is sort of at that stage. So
every club, it goes around in circles. Every club's going to have a rebuilding phase. It's just Dapto's turn at the moment.
Yeah, it could be a long afternoon for them too. Going off last week's result.
Yeah, look, if the Butchers can play near as good as what they did on the weekend, they're going to be way too good for the Canaries. It's always good beating Dapto, isn't it?
Definitely. Who are we looking at for Dapto?
Oh, you got to go with Jeff Robson. You know, 250-odd NRL games. It's a wealth of experience. His short kicking game has been sensational, not only last year but to start this season. He'll definitely lead the Canaries around the paddock. You look at Troy Pieper. He's playing number 6. There was Jake Hawkins there the other day, but he wasn't named on the weekend. So we'll just see which way that coach Penny Lightbold and Mick Murph go in that way. But look, the Butchers forwards are just going to, they'll out tough, they'll out muscle the Canaries forwards. I'd rather have Damian Sironen and also Jack Noble on my team than Varchez and Reece Bowditch.
Yeah, I was told or read something that Jake actually played really well for the
Canaries
last week.
Yeah, so
I'm not sure if that was his first game back.
Yeah,
now I know
he's been up north, up near Foster, playing in that competition that he played. not sure who was playing with up there, but he ran around in that competition. I think he won a comp up there with him. So there was
captain coach.
Yeah, there was talk of him coming down and playing in Group 7, but the Canaries must have flashed a little bit more freight than what the Stingrays could. And
that doesn't happen, does it? No. Yeah, right. So that's this Saturday at 3 p.m. Are you calling?
Yeah, look, that's the that will be a Bar TV game. Hopefully, I'm down there with Mitch Jennings. Wait and see.
Dynamic
which
duo.
Way the dynamic duo go.
Let's have a chat about these names you keep coming up with. Damian Sironen, the European statue.
Yeah, look, Mitch was in awe of his physique the other day.
Man crush?
He got a bit of a bot on him. So Mitch was just in awe of just the physique. He was just standing there and looked like a statue. And he's just a big body on the field. And
right, eh?
He's one of them boys that just takes that ball under his wing and goes forward. And he's been super impressive so far this season.
There's got to be a player out there that has their phone in that shed. So if you can get us a
picture of his rig.
His rig, so we can throw it up there. We'll try and find you a prize. Not that it'll be very expensive or something. Might be a schooner. Right, so that's this Saturday at Dapto Showground from 3 p.m. Club events. Again, there's still not a lot on. There's a rumour that there might be a sports luncheon coming up through the year, and when we get some more details, we'll put them up. And hopefully, we're going to chase up Paul Eyre to try and get on here and give us a bit of a chat about the club and whatever. But he's not too good with technology, I don't think, Paul. It's hard to get an email reply or a phone call back or text, so I'll chase him down and do the best I can. Old boys raffle again, Sundays at Beaches, and that's probably from about 4:45. I'm not sure who's doing it this year, or this week, I should say. Club website and membership. There's a membership drive going on at the moment. You've only missed one game. It's $100. The club has 47 members already. They're chasing 50, and that'll be the biggest membership they've had. So if you want to jump on board, head to the website. All the information's there. You can sign up, or you can give Trent Morgan a ring. His number's on that as well. So we're chasing 50. Money's very important. You might think it's a lot, but to the club, like $5,000 can do a lot of stuff for us. E-newsletter. There's a newsletter that goes out as often as it can. So you can sign up for that on the website as well. It's on the right-hand side of it. Just put your details in, and then there's one going out this week after the committee meeting, and Johnny's column. Johnny's jumped on board, and he's going to give us a rundown, a preview, and his thoughts on each game. So this week it'll be Dapto, so look for that. That's up on Fridays. And that's about it for week two. Thanks for coming.
No, all good. Done and dusted. We'll just touch on the New South Wales and Queensland Residents game.
Yeah.
Billy Millard coached that side.
He did.
Name round Thirroul. So a bit unlucky in that game. Billy's team pretty much got it handed to him.
From the word go.
Yeah. So, and also Benny Lynn's side, the under-18s SG ball side, went up to Queensland to play in what they called the Super Bowl. They come up against a Tweed Heads side up there that won the Queensland version of the New South Wales competition, and they weren't too successful on the day, but good experience for these young kids to go up, travel up overnight and go and play. They played at the Redcliffe Dolphins home ground that
good
wouldn't look out of place at an NRL fixture.
Yeah, definitely.
So it was a good experience for those guys to go up there. A couple of Thirroul Butchers went up there as well, so well done to that team for going, you know, all the way through. They won the New South Wales, they went up and played the Super Bowl. Couldn't quite get the big W up there, but good experience, and look, all those kids will be better for the run.
Just on that, Dan Nolan, I was talking to him the other day, and he's actually got a promotion, and he's now the head of the high performance strength and conditioning, I think. So well done to him.
He's done a good job. Like on the weekend, you looked at that Thirroul side, and I know the score was 50-8, but just the fitness of the Butchers was just, it's head and shoulders above anyone in this competition. It has been for the last couple of years. And look, Dan's doing a good job there with the Butchers, but also throughout the these junior Steelers that are coming through.
Yeah, definitely. There was a really good centre I seen in that SG ball game for Tweed, number 3. Real big, tall guy, and he sort of tore him apart a bit.
Yeah, there's some,
I can't think of his name, but he was really good. Just on, like SG Ball, there's a lot of coaches that are coming out of Thirroul.
Yeah.
But like stepping up the rep side and stuff. I know Billy Millard, he's a Souths coach, but he was the Cutters. He was the SG ball coach, and then before Benny. Benny's in there. I know Jacko's had a bit of a stint in there, I think with the 17s development squad. And there's others, I believe, that are in the country rugby league.
In the system.
System too, as coaches. So, doing good things out here at the moment. Thirroul,
well, Paulie Hatchell, who was assistant to Benny Lynn, with that under-18s.
And he's got the women's league tag, I think. So, it's not only good players. The club seems to be in a really good spot at the moment.
Well, you touch on the women's, it's just gone through the roof. Women's rugby league, women's league tag. Well, they're playing it down here on Friday nights for the juniors even. There's just so many junior league tags at the moment. And Thirroul got a lot of teams in that through that junior system. So a couple of very successful sides as well. So look for them throughout the year at that pointy end of the competition to hold that trophy aloft.
So, the women's participation, you're right, it's just exploded. I'm going to check and find out
Natasha Gale under-18 side, they won the New South Wales, the Illawarra Steelers.
Apparently she played for Bulleye.
Yeah, Natasha Gale originally played with Bulleye.
I'll have a check and see how many female teams we've got. I know Toddy Gross has got a league tag side too that go all right. But anyway, juniors are strong, the seniors are strong, and the club looks to be strong too. So anyway, thanks for joining us this week, and we'll be back next week. Thanks, Johnny.
Look, thanks to the Ryans for the sponsorship and for holding us here for a second week in a row. Who would have thought we'd get 2 weeks out of this? We'll go.
New venue, new sort of area too. Main bar. It brought us down from upstairs. All right, thanks, everybody. Talk to you next week.